The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content.
Good morning, all. My name is Sooraj, and I'm a graduate student at Arizona State University. Our group, the topic that I'm going to present here is microstructural packing, rheology, and RAM extrusion characteristics of 3D printable binders. We are mostly focusing on cement-based materials. So just in brief introduction, many have been going through their presentations, but literally printing when 3D is what 3D printing is. What we print on papers in 2D or 2D, we are making it into like 3D. And there have been research going on in 3D printing of concrete with small scale elements, and the people have been successful in bringing up models like the few which have been given here, like an acoustic damping wall element or a high-performance multifunctional wall. So one of the main processes that we follow in concrete 3D printing is layer-wise material extrusion process. So there are different types of 3D printing processes, but we focus on layer-wise material extrusion process. I'm going to play a few videos of just another music. So the first process on the left side that shows a layer-wise extrusion using cement base material, and you can see that there is a barrel which extrudes the paste and layer-wise being laid, and the properties of the mixes and the way in which we are printing it will decide how the output quality of the print is. You can see that it's pretty much decently being printed layer by layer, and there's no failure of these layers. And I'll just briefly take another lecture, another video, which is for a, that's inverted, I'm sorry about that, but that's for a screw extrusion method. So unlike RAM extrusion, where you have a barrel and you push the material out, you have a screw which rotates and then takes the material out. And again, the same process, the material properties and the way in which it's been printed decides the quality. And we have been pretty successful in using a screw extrusion method as well. And you can see an image which is shown there for another print that has been made with this. Now, so as I was saying, so focus on layered extrusion. And the material should be soft enough to be extruded while it should intermix with the already laid layers so that it has a stable structure being prepared. And as you go on printing layer by layer, the layers beneath the current layer should be able to hold the weight of the the layers being laid. And that weight, again, if it comes on the layers beneath, if the material is not able to hold it, which depends on the yield stress of the material, it won't be able to be stable. So the other factors that we need to look at are the finite waiting time between the layers, because as you move on layer by layer, the layers which have been already laid should be like stiff enough to hold the upcoming layers. And then the yield stress change from layer to structure when you extrude the material. Although we have an yield stress which we measure using a rheological technique, a rheometer, when you extrude it, the material gets packed, and then there's a difference, there's a change in the yield stress that it comes out as it comes out through the extruder. And then the rate of buildup and the operating times as well are factors which decides if the material is printable or not. So how do we design a material and a system for the purpose? It depends on various factors, and we should like decide on the materials which we need to print, how we portion the materials, and then the mixing and the extrusion process. All these factors decide how to design the material and the system for the purpose. And we could like broadly divide them into preprint and postprint properties as shown. And then the preprint properties of the material that goes into the printing, we can evaluate them using rheological and extrude extrusion characterization techniques, whereas a post print depends on the shape stability and the mechanical properties in general. So there are lack of guidelines for deciding these materials, and we try to predict the post print behavior using preprint properties. Like, we evaluate the materials properties in terms of rheology and extrudability. So these are the methods which I already trying to be focused on, RAM extruder, and if we divide the research approach into three, where we allow rheology, extrusion, and then we have simulated microstructural packing parameters which we could relate to these rheological and extrusion characteristics to come up with, you know, to say if a material is printable or not. So in rheology, we are focusing on parallel plate test and a tack test, and extrusion, a lab scale extrusion setup, which we'll discuss in the coming slides. So we had paste mixtures 3D printed using RAM extrusion. This typical geometry is being given, and then the shapes that we decided to go for, it's our cubes of different layer dimensions as shown, and those are actual pictures. And we have in general three types of mixers, which are like a few non-printable mixers, which we'll discuss how or why they're non-printable, and then printable without superplasticizers being added in the mixtures, and printable without superplasticizers. So a few mixers have been identified based on trial and error basis. And these are the mixers that we have, of which the first two, which are plain OPC and one with 30% fly ash replacement, those are non-printable. And then we have a few printable mixers with superplasticizer and without superplasticizer. Now, if you see, these are the yield stress measurement from the rheological experiments, and as you go for mixers from the non-printable side to the with superplasticizer side, you can see a general increase in the yield stress materials. And these materials have in experiments, like in lab itself, has shown better printability in terms of shape stability also. And this is a graph which relates the yield stress that we measured from these experiments with, when we multiply with the mean centroidal distance square. And when you connect it with the solid volume fraction, you see a relation which complements one of the presentations from Iman. He showed a similar variation. So as the solid volume fraction increases, you have an exponential increase in the factor that has been shown there. So as I mentioned, there are three categories, and one of the reasons for this increase, this high increase in the yield stress, is because of the solid volume fraction. But there is a loose network, like a printable mixture, which it will have a good yield stress, but it will be pretty loose in the network of particles that it has prepared, that it is able to deform. But when it is too stiff, or like when the solid volume fraction is too high, then that network is like so stiff that it won't be able to be extruded. So that's why this OPC, the OPC mix is showing a high yield stress, but it's not like printable. But everything else is in the regime that is for printable mixes. When it comes to the adhesive property, we did a tack test where we have a material between two plates and we separate it, and we see how the load is being recorded in the separation process. So different mixes show different peak force and then the corresponding deformation in which it without breaking, like shown in the image. So the adhesive energy is the area under the graph of this curve, and as you can see, for printable mixers, especially the superplasticizer mixer, there's a slight increase in the adhesive energy, which is a characteristic which we need for intermixing of the layers, and those mixers are pretty successful in doing that. In the extrudability experiments, we have a barrel with material mixed in, put in it, and we extrude it slowly in different speeds. So the graph shown is, as the RAM displacement increase and then the RAM force increase, but there are different velocities involved. So in each of these steps, I have a different velocity, and the velocity decreases from 150 to 90. So I have a steady state pressure which corresponds to each of those velocities. I am recording it here. So it's a multi-velocity procedure, and then we extract the steady state pressure for different velocities from it. And we use a model which is widely used in literature, which is called the Benbow-Bridgewater model, which has a relationship between the pressure which we use to extract two pressures, which is die entry and die land. So die entry pressure is the pressure required for the material to shape into the die, whereas the die land is what is required for the material to pass the die, the nozzles case. So we can separate out those pressures using this equation. Now, these here are shown for the same experimental results as shown from the earlier slide for different L by D ratios, basically the nozzle diameter, nozzle length to the nozzle entry diameter. So for these, for different L by D ratios, if we have the steady state pressures, we could use this to extract parameters. And the graph shows the yield stress that has been the extrusion yield, which is sigma naught here, being extracted from the extrusion yield, which is sigma naught plus alpha we extruded from the equation. So the error bar shows for different velocities that we have, and you can see that there is a that we need to have a control on the extrusion yield stress as well as the wall shear stress. The lower it is, the better. So it is easier to shape. In that case, it is easier to shape, and then there's a reduced wall friction stresses involved. And you can see that in the case of superplasticized mixers here, there is a reduction in the wall shear stresses when compared to the die entry stresses or the extrusion yield stresses. So that is basically because there is the particles in the, when it pass into the die, they gets locked, and then there is a reduced Brownian motion when compared to a non-printable mix, where particles are so scattered and the Brownian motion will increase the friction across within the wall. So that is why there is a reduction in the yield stress values which are shown for the superplasticized mixes. So you can see that there is an increase in although there are superplasticized mixes have a higher particle fraction, there is a reduction in the wall stresses because of the reduced Brownian motion that we have that we see. This is just a summary on recorded values. So the extrusion yield stress, it usually generally varies between 100 to 200 kilopascals, and the shear yield stress from the rotational rheometry, it is between 150 to 500 pascals. And these results have been already been shown, and these are for a few alkali activated mixes also. So as mentioned earlier, the wall shear slip shear stresses determines the printing, the pressure and the phase separation. So if you have too high stress coming in, then there will be particles separating out unless the mix is capable to still hold the material particles within it without any separation. And so that's why I told that the lower the yield stress, the pressure involved, the better. But if the material is properly designed, then even if we have a high yield stress, so high printing pressure, we'll be able to avoid this phase separation. Now, coming to the microstructural packing part, where we define a microstructural packing coefficient based on the number density, coordination number, and mean centroidal distance. We simulate the particle packing for different mixes which we have selected here, and a few images have been shown. So once we simulate these microstructural situations, we evaluate these the parameter based on these recorded numbers from the simulated microstructural packing, and you can see that generally from the non-printable to the printable mixes, there is a high increase in microstructural packing factor, which is basically showing that the mixes are they are capable of being printed as shown, which correlates with the results being shown earlier in the earlier slides. And this is the packing, the fraction divided by the D50 square, and being related to the microstructural packing parameter. And you can see that the non-printable mixes are in the extreme left regime here, whereas the others are showing a significant value in the trends. And that's because of like high packing values that has been shown by the printable mixes with the superplasticizers. And they usually follow a general linear trend as shown. So the packing factor for non-printable mixers, and as you move to the printable mixers, increases, and then the plastic shear yield stress is in agreement with the particle packing, because these materials showed higher yield stress as well, and that is being related to the microstructural parameter. So this is a good means of showing that whether a mix is printable or not. These are correlation graphs from So I'll quickly go through it. So the extrusion yield stress versus the peak, the tack test peak force shows a general increase in trend, because as the addition, so in the peak force, it's like how the interparticle forces are. So if those are higher, then that shows a higher extrusion yield stress as well. Now, in the microstructural parameter, when it compared with the wall shear stress, there's a reduction in the value, which is related to the Brownian motion that we have discussed, and then the extrusion yield stress and wall slip shear stress generally has a inverse relationship as shown. So in summary, we can use microstructural packing coefficient to predict whether the mixers are suitable for printing or not, and then the extrusion modeling of cement paste shows direct correlation with the rheological parameters. And then these, although has been done on paste mixers, could be extended to mortar and concrete in RAM extrusion. Thank you.